experience. Talk about a terrifying being before the Almighty God and Creator. It must have been a great thing for Moses to see. He'd been at the burning bush. We all read that already. But he was there again before the presence of God. He watched God bring forth the plagues upon Egypt. He opened the Red Sea, which we studied before. He'd got water from the spring of a rock. Do you remember that? And then he brought manna from heaven, from God's very hand. He's like, you hungry? Here you go, son. Here's a little bit of food. All the time getting to know God better, a little bit at a time. But now he has invited him to live with him, to speak with him, to meet with him. He had the opportunity to be before God himself. Imagine that. How awesome is that? Just think about God giving us the opportunity to be in his presence. And unless you don't realize this by now, he does that. He did that by the Son that he shed on that cross, his blood, so that we can be redeemed. So Exodus 24 is an invitation given to draw near to God on the mountaintop. You ever had a mountaintop experience? With one of the ministries that I was in Abide, we used to go once a year. We used to go to the Mammoth or, you know, the mountaintop, right? I'll tell you what, guys, it's the hardest thing. My leaders at the time, they loved to run. They loved to hike. We'd get up there, and I was like, whoo, I might not make it. My heart's coming out. But when you get up there, it's untouched. It's bliss. It's a great place to do a devotion, a great place to spend time with God in prayer. But it's a difficult road. We almost want to give up as we continue that climb. And I take that the same way with my walk. As I continue this path, as you continue this walk with your God, things start to get difficult. Things start to come before you. Things start to want to crush you, your very existence. But then God says, just come a little bit further. And when you get to the top, if you've ever experienced that, it's a great thing. It is a beautiful thing to be in the presence of an almighty God. Amen? So do me a favor and open up your Bibles to Exodus 24. As like I said, we're going to cover a couple of these verses. Exodus 24. And what does it mean to be in God's presence? Let me give you that answer. Psalm 16:11 says, you have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasure at your right hand. Did you catch that? God himself. Psalms 27:4 says, one thing I ask of the Lord, that is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. Man, what a sight is that. Psalms 95:2 says, let us come unto his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make joyful noise to him with song and praise. Man, if you haven't catched that yet in these three verses, God is inviting you and I into his presence. Since he wants to know us more intimately, his presence in our life is known the moment we receive him into our heart. According to Christian doctrine, each and every one of us was created for worship, was created for something greater. But see, this world wants to entice you. It wants to suck you in. I don't know about you guys, but for 30 years of my life, because I came to the Lord when I was 30, for 30 years of my life, I had this gaping hole that I couldn't fill with violence. I couldn't fill with drugs. I couldn't fill with alcohol. I couldn't fill with pornography. I couldn't fill with women. And I just longed for something more, and I could never get it. And it got to the point where my God said, you know what? Enough is enough. He took my daughter home. And that shook my very essence. And I made a deal with God. I said, you know what, Lord? If you save her, I will give my life to you. And see, you might think, well, you know, brother, did he talk to you audibly? No, he didn't, because he took her home. But the promise is in the Bible that I will see her again. And because the promise is there, I will run that race that Paul says. I will run with endurance. I will not quit. I will not stop chasing after my God, because I do want to see her again. And just like many of you, we've lost a lot of friends and loved ones. Recently, we've lost a lot of people in the body, but guess what? We have an eternity to spend time with them. there is that gaping hole that must be filled. And it could only be filled with God. I can't explain it to you, but if you've lived this out already, when God came into my life, that longing, that desire, the thing that I was trying to fill with stuff, that hole that I was trying to fill with lust, all the things that I was trying to fill were gone. I had no necessity, guys. I guess that's the reason why I'm the overseer for One Step, because they can't tell me, hey, brother, you know what? You don't know what it's like to be on drugs. Oh, yes, I do. You don't know what it's like to struggle with cigarettes and alcohol. Oh, yes, I do. But because I know how to overcome these things. And it's not by my power. It's not by my might. It's by God himself. God wants to have an intimate relationship with you, but he can't because he is holy. And therefore, you must be cleansed to be holy. And that's what we're going to see here. These men had to be cleansed. These rituals had to take place because we have to atone for our sins. We have to atone for our shortcomings. So to fail to relate to God and what he wants from us is to fail human society. Because God wants to have an eternal relationship with you, but he can't because sin. We're a fallen world. We're all living in this fallen world. It's been given over to the devil and his enemies. I believe it was Plato who compared human beings to leaky jars. One of the pastors once says, the reason we pray for the infilling of the Holy Spirit is because we're like broken jars and we leak. We pour all sorts of things in our lives to fill the inner void with hope of being filled, yet we find that we never fill that hole. These things do not satisfy you. So there's always another river to cross, another mountain to climb in the search of whatever you're looking for. Have you found it yet? Have you got that yet? I remember when I bought my first hot rod, it was a 1967 Chevy Camaro. I loved that thing more than my wife. I said, she will leave before that car goes. Sad to say, guys, that car is worth a lot of money and I don't own it anymore. The car went. I still have the wife. Yet, possibly for you, this sense of distance can set up a firm foundation for you. You can find that place with God. Let me ask you a question. Are there things in your life which you hope you can fulfill for you, but turned out to be less fulfilling? Did you try to fill it with something? Did you try to fill that gap with stuff, with things, with lust, but you can't feel it? You continue to chase after. All this introduces us in Exodus 24. We have been and are still longing in this journey in Exodus. This story is an epic adventure. There have been many dramatic moments, harsh slavery, the burning bush, the 10 plagues, the crossing of the Red Sea, the giving of the commandments, and the book of the covenant. As we continue to unravel this magnificent book, we see these things. We see the forecoming of what is to come, man. If you've been studying this book like we have, you see that it lays it all out for what's to come. And we see that today. I was telling my pastors, I was reading through this, and I was looking at it, and I was reading it, and I was taking my notes. I'm like, man, that sounds like the first church service. But instead, I titled it In His Presence, because that's where we are. Exodus 21 says that the Lord told Moses, come up to the Lord. Did you see that? He said, come up. He invited him up as he invites us to come forward. Every Sunday night, the pastor always does an altar call. Why? Because when you come forward, you're taking a step of faith, just like he told Moses to come. It was a step of faith because he knows his God. He knows what his God can do and what he has done. Here in Exodus 24, Moses confirmed the covenant between God and his people. Moses acts as a mediator, a priest, as he enters the presence of God and on behalf of the people. It's almost like if Moses was a God-man as he straddles heaven and earth. But Moses, he's not a God-man. The whole passage speaks practically of the real God-man, Jesus, who made mediation for the whole world. Huh? What do you mean by that, brother? Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2 with me, verse 5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Just catch that. He is our mediator. So here, Moses is preparing that so that we could see the forecoming of the Lord and what he's going to do and what he has done. Jesus has opened up for us a new and living way so that we can draw near to God and come into his presence. See, we don't have to do a lot of these rituals, a lot of these things, so that we could go before God's presence. But I will warn you, brothers, don't walk in there without with your sin plain as day. Don't walk in here with your practicing your sin. You need to repent. Because I'll tell you what, in almost the 20 years that I've been walking with the Lord, I cannot be here in my own strength and power. But in his strength and his power, he gives that. He wants to use you in a mighty way, but he can't if you do not atone for your transgressions before God. Look at Hebrews chapter 10, verses 19 to 22. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Here the book of Hebrews compares Moses with Jesus and says that Jesus is the greater Moses. Jesus is the mediator between God the Father and us here on earth. He is the one that goes before you. He is the one that paid the ultimate price for you. How can you not give your whole heart and your whole life to something that big? I remember a day when these pews were halfway full of men that desire to grow, that desire to know God more intimately. What has happened to us men? Have I failed them? Have we failed them? Do we demonstrate Jesus as we walk in these streets? Do we demonstrate God as we speak to strangers at the mall or at the supermarket? Or are we walking around like we got baptized in lemon juice? Hey, how you doing? What's so good about today? Who? Don't you go to Calvary Chapel High Desert? Don't you go to the men's study? Man, I remember those days when we wanted to be here. When I longed, I was like, it's almost Tuesday, I get to be with my brothers. Is that your heart? Is that my heart? Or are we just becoming complacent because this world is upside down? Or are we so terrified of this disease that it's going to ultimately go through this whole world and twice and three times around? I expect to get it again. But now I had it twice. So you know what? The third time shouldn't be as bad. It should be like a sniffle. But see, we can't walk in fear, man. We need to walk in confidence of what God has done in our lives. Read with me Hebrews chapter 3, verse 3. For this one has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who built the house has more honor than the house. Did you catch that? It's all about Jesus. Moses is just preparing it for God. Hebrews describes Jesus as being a greater high priest, our mediator. Hebrews 7:26 says, such a high priest meets our needs. He meets your needs and my needs. He's all we need, man, to fill that gaping hole. So if you still feel that you need to fill that with something, guess what? You fill it with his word. You fill it with his fellowship. You fill it with worship. You fill it with total surrender. As we have already said, that there's within each one of us a deep spiritual longing, something that this earth can never feel. Such a high priest meets these needs. C.S. Lewis puts it like this, and I paraphrase. Books and music in which we think beauty is located will betray us. If we trust in them, it is not in them, it is only through them, and what comes through them is longing. These things, the beauty and the memory of our past, are good images of what we really desire. But if they are mistakes for the things itself, they turn into dumb idols, breaking the hearts of the worshipers. For they are not the things itself, they are only the sense of the flowers that are not found. They are only the echoes of the tunes we have not heard, news from the country we have not visited. Augustine, famous words which arose from this experience, echoed the same sentence. O Lord, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are relentless until they find their rest in you. Why do I quote these people? Because these people are long dead. We do not learn from the past mistakes. We have a tendency, man, to make our own mistakes. We do not learn from the past. The past has been given to us so that we can grow and learn from it. And what do? I'm going to do it my way. That's why that one song was it Frank Sinatra? I did it my way, right? When you die, is that the song they're going to be playing? I did it my way, Christian, my way, right? that progressive movement, right? Let's get a female pastor up here. Let's have rainbows on the brother, you know? Are we starting to conform to this world? Or are we standing firm in what the Word of God says? I would rather that every man be a liar than my God to be a liar. Because I tell you what, He has restored my marriage. He has restored everything I lost. He has restored my salvation and my strength in Him. He has restored my children and my wife of 31 years. And He can do this for you. Question, have you found peace with God? Is your heart at rest with your Creator? Or are you relentless? Still searching for something you haven't found? What are you looking for? There's nothing out there for you. Exodus 24 is as breathtaking as it is magnificent, as Moses confirms the old covenant in the presence of God. Yet all this, says Hebrews, was only a shadow of good things to come, not the reality themselves. I'm going to give you some points. These points are found in Christ Jesus. I'm going to give you 3 points, and then we're out of here. You ready? Point number one, Moses reads the word. Moses reads the word. Jesus is the word. Point number two, Moses presents a sacrifice. Moses presents a sacrifice. Jesus is the sacrifice. Point number three, Moses eats and drinks. Jesus is the food and drink for the sacrifice. These points, and hopefully you can understand as we go through this. Let's look at point number one. Moses reads the word, and Jesus is the word, the living word. Exodus 24, verse 3. So Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord has said, we will do. It is worth pointing out that in this chapter, it contains the elements of Christian service of worship. Except for the singing, and Moses is the worship leader, a Christian service of worship is to come together into God's presence to worship. We have here in Exodus 24 an invitation to approach God, the reading and the exposition of the Word of God, responding in faith in the blood and the sacrament meal, the family meal that we take, these sacraments that only through Christ on the cross can we come and partake. Did you see that? The beauty of the first service? That's why we gather, man. This is just a building. You are the living church. What you represent, you are an ambassador of Christ. Do you understand that? And here's the thing, guys. Don't misunderstand me, okay? I'm not telling you you can't come. You know, a lot of people say, well, you know, Jesus says come as you are. The Word says come as you are. But here's the thing. If you're an ambassador, right? When I go, I work for the government, so when I'm asked to go somewhere else and represent my company, right? I dress nice. I dress up so that they can show me that respect and show me that, you know, like I'm here on behalf of my company. So when you come, are you coming just like, man, I just woke up. I've seen people in their sandals and, or even in their slippers. They're walking around. I'm like, bro, those are slippers. They're like, yeah, these are expensive ones. I'm like, oh, you're in pajamas. Or are you coming to worship? I don't know about you, but when I come to worship, I want to be here for God. I don't want distractions. I don't want to be like, is he in his pajamas? Are those dolphins on his legs? I want to be in the presence of God. Look at verse 4 of Exodus 24. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord, and he arose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. These were the Ten Commandments of the Book of the Covenant that we saw in Exodus 19:23. Apparently, the first draft of the Old Testament having written down, Moses then read it again, which reminds us that we need to read, or those of you that drive and listen to the Word of God over and over again. Have you read the Bible through a year? Then read it again. Have you failed and said, I'm done? No, start over, guys. We don't quit because we've missed a chapter. We don't quit because we're going through trials and tribulations. Instead, this should be the desire to continue forth and to be strengthened by His Word. The Word of God is living. It transforms you. Men, take it from me. Those of you that know me personally know the man that I used to be. And if you don't know, I was a bad man. You think Paul was bad? I was a bad man. I deserve hell for everything I've done. And here I stand before you, a transformed man, a new man, because I've been washed by the blood. I've been cleansed and renewed. I would look up to my leaders and say, man, I want to be one of those guys. I want to grow like those guys. Man, where do they study at? It's simple. Show up. Do your homework. Spend that time in the Word. If you have questions, ask them. What I used to do back in the day is if I saw a word I didn't understand, I would highlight it. I would look it up. And then if I couldn't pronounce it, I would go back and put it on the dictionary thing, and it would tell me the word. It would say it. You know, a female lady would come on and say, you know, Exodus, you know. Study. If you don't understand, bring it to us. We can help you. The Bible says, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So that's what he's doing here. He's preparing the way for Jesus. Let me ask you another question. Do you allow the Holy Spirit to help you in the reading of the Bible? Do you go humbly before your God and ask God, Lord, help me? Does the Lord speak to you through the Bible? Because he does for me. You don't need to hear God audibly like, hey, Alex, I want to talk to you today. No. See, our communication with God is this. I get up, I say, Lord, I come before you. Please forgive me of any of my transgressions, Lord, and help me to be a better man. And then I pray. And then after I pray, I read. And then when I'm reading, I'm like, oh, this is awesome. Then my wife's like, hey, babe, I just talked to so-and-so, and they're going through this and that. And I'm like, perfect. You know what? The Word of God says this, this, and this. And she's like, oh, man, when did you read that? I just read that right now. And she's like, that's awesome. That's how God speaks to us, guys. And I'm telling you, if you do this, you will see your God speak. Point number two, Moses presents a sacrifice. Jesus is the sacrifice. Let me show you how. Exodus 24, 5 through 8. Then he sent young men of the children of Israel who offered burnt offering and sacrifice, peace of offering of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in the basins and half of the blood and sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read in the hearing of the people. And they said, all that the Lord has said we will do and be obedient. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it to the people and said, this is the blood of the covenant which the Lord has made with you according to all these words. So let's take a look at this. Animal sacrifice. It's a hard thing to understand, right? Because we don't do that now. So why did they need it? Why can't we just come straight to God? Why can't we go straight from verse 2 to verse 9? Why is the blood of the sacrifice needed? The reason for the blood of the sacrifice is sin. This sin is directed towards sin, guys. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22 says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Did you see that? God is holy, and therefore, because he's holy, we are sinful, unholy people. We can't just come rushing into God's house saying, hey, Lord, here I am. You love me, right? Boom. If that happened, guys, imagine how many of us on Sunday would be terrified. I know I would. Because why? Your sin has to be dealt with. Your sin has to be atoned for. You can't just walk in and pretend everything's going to be okay. That's the problem we have. We don't go with that reverence. We don't go before a mighty God and say, you know what, Lord, I have failed you. Please forgive me. Transform me. Make me new. We just like, oh, yeah, man, I'm sorry. Sorry for what? I got caught. You come with a repentant heart and say, you know what, I transgressed against you. Or do you just come in and say, you know what, I messed up? See, we see here that there are two offerings were offered. The first whole burnt offering and then the fellowship offering. In the burnt offering, the whole animal was consumed by fire. And it's represented as a full atonement for your sin and for my sin. And a total dedication to God. The fellowship offering represented peace with God. That was the offering that was burnt in the fire, cooked, and served for dinner. That's that meal that you have, that koinonia when you eat together, and then you pray for it. Why? Because first your sin has to be atoned, and then you can go before a God and have a meal before your God. The first of the blood had to be drained into a large bowl. Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the altar. Then he took the other half of the sprinkled it on the people. This sounds a little bit gross to some people, but take a look at it with me. because it's a very meaningful thing. The idea of the blood of the covenant would have a familiarity in ancient times. We sometimes talk about blood brothers, right? Like, hey, bro, you want to be my blood brother? Here, let's poke each other, and we're going to shake hands, right? You know, some people used to do the nasty thing and spit, right? Like, right? Let's be blood brothers. So it has the same thing. It becomes a peace with God and his people. Exodus 24:8 says that this is the blood of the covenant. You're making a covenant before your God. We can only really understand Jesus if we understand the Old Testament background. All the sacrifices of the Old Testament pointed to a practical sacrifice of the Messiah. Everything that happened in the Old Testament was so that you could understand what's about to happen, what Jesus had to do on that cross, what he was about to go through. Look at Matthew chapter 26 with me, starting in verse 27. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many of you and for the remission of sin. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Did you see that? You see that? At the Last Supper, Jesus takes the cup and gives thanks and gives it to them, saying, drink of this. This is my blood of the covenant. They're like, what? That's nasty. What are you talking about, blood? Did you cut yourself? Which was poured out for forgiveness of sin. See, he was talking about something that was to come. We drink grape juice. When we do the communion, we drink grape juice. We don't drink blood, guys. It's not one of those weird religions where they say that that's the actual blood of Christ. Yeah, don't even get me started with that. But Moses here says this is the blood of the covenant. He's saying to this, they're making a covenant with God. We come to God into his presence through faith in the blood of Christ that was shed on the cross. Only the blood of Christ has the power to cleanse us of our sins, to cover your transgressions. Everything you have ever done and everything you will ever do, only through his blood can it be covered. Jesus said that he is the mediator of the new covenant. This is the sprinkled blood that was shed on Calvary. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 23 and 24. To the general assembly and the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of the sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel. Do you see that? He is the new covenant. His blood poured out for our transgressions will only be the thing that covers our sin. Let me ask you one last question. Can you say for sure my sins are forgiven? Can you say for sure that your sins are covered by the blood of Jesus? Do you know Jesus died for you? If you do not know that, then it's time to confess in faith and take that step forward. A lot of times we think we know, but you'd be surprised how many times I talk to people that are seasoned veterans and they're saying, I don't know if I'm saved. You should know. Because if today is the day that God calls you home, you better know that you know that you know. Our last point, and lastly, in closing, Moses eats and drinks. Jesus is the food and the drink. Read with me Exodus 24, verses 9 through 11. Then Moses went up, also Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the God of Israel, and there was under his feet as if were paved work of sapphire stone, and it was like the very heavens in its clarity. But on the nobles of the children of Israel, he did not lay his hands. So they saw God, and they ate and drank. You see that? Moses and the leaders of the Israelites had the theophany of God, of a God experience in a mountaintop. And they ate in a sacred meal with God, kind of like we do in communion when we take it. They saw the God of Israel, but we are not told much about beyond that point. This reminds us of Holy Communion, does it not? And we also have a glimpse of great and final feast in the kingdom of God. There will be food in heaven. I'm telling you, some of us are foodies. I love food. I love the taste, the different elements of food. My friend Sean does, and he's like, oh, food is just fuel. Bro, you got bad taste buds. Something's wrong with your taste buds. Because I'll tell you what, I'm like Ratatouille. I don't know if you guys ever seen that with your grandkids or your kids. You know, that little rat that makes food. And I'm like, man, that is so good. It pops in my mouth. we went to eat dumplings, and I got these dumplings that have this little juice in them, and I made everybody try one. I go, watch, it's going to pop in your mouth. So I know there's going to be food in heaven. I'm going to be in there cooking for you guys one day. Moses eats and drinks in God's presence. However, Jesus is the food and the drink. Jesus is the greater Moses, and Jesus meets our needs. John chapter 6, verse 55 says, "For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink." All the food and all the drink is just signs and foreshadows of this true food and drink of the kingdom of God. Food and drink which satisfies. Jesus is not talking about cannibalism. He is saying that through the cross, my sacrifice body and poured out blood will find what you're searching for. That big gaping hole you have will be filled the moment you understand the cross. The moment I understood what John 3:16 really meant, that's the moment I understood the sacrifice on the cross. God wants us to experience his presence. This means setting aside time to come into his presence. From what we have seen and been learning, how can we come into his presence? Great question. The world promises to offer so much pleasure, beauty, personal relationships. Yet when we finally grasp them, when we find what we are searching for and seeking, these are all lies, and they're beyond lies. Have you ever noticed what happens when you want something so bad and you get it? That new job, that marriage partner, that qualification, that pay raise, that nice house. You think when you get these things that you'll be satisfied and ask for nothing more. Then it doesn't work, or it's like that old thing, right? Like that phone, that cell phone you carry, right? I was telling everybody at One Step, I'm like, man, I want that new phone, right? I don't need a phone. My phone is perfectly fine, right? But then you got my brother, my pastor friend, he's walking around, he's got the new phone. My brother has the new phone, and I'm like, I got the old phone. They're like, look at the pictures, bro. And I'm like, man, my pictures are cool. We always want more. We get the things. I got the Camaro. I had that thing in my hands. It was mine. I drove it. I raced it. I almost crashed it. But then when I got it, I wanted more. At one point, I had like 11 cars in my house. None of them were running right, but I had all these old cars. We don't have enough. Why? Because you have something missing. And that is a true relationship with your Lord and Savior. John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Do you know that? Do you know that you need your God to bring you to that place? Are you ready to be tested and tried in the sanctification process, becoming more Christ-like? I'll tell you this, and I think you've heard it before. A faith that cannot be tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. Can your faith be trusted tonight? Maybe you're here tonight and you feel that you're unworthy of his presence. Maybe you feel that the things that you have done would not allow you to draw near to God and your heavenly Father. Maybe you feel you've done too much. Have you gone before God and asked for forgiveness? That's all it takes. I'm dead serious. I'm there. Maybe you're feeling that your home is in turmoil. Your marriage is upside down. Your wife doesn't honor or respect you. Your children don't love and respect you. Maybe your children are on the streets running amok. God is able to bring his grace in each and every one of these situations, man. Trust me. My youngest does worship for me. How awesome is that? But they need to see you do it. They need to see you honoring your God. They need to see you reading the word. They need to see you praying for people and praying for others and praying for them and for yourself. So maybe you're asking your question right now. How can I do this, you ask? We must start by admitting to a holy God that we are sinners in need of repentance, of transgressions, to seek him wholeheartedly. Friday night, I taught on redemption because it was about how can we stop sinning. And I'll tell you this quote that I gave them. The key to resisting temptation is not resistance, but submission. I'll say it again. The key to resisting temptation is not resistance, but submission. You submit into God and his law, and I will show you a new man. You surrender that man that you're carrying, those evil desires, those passions that you still drive around with, those things that you think people don't see, right? We all have these little fancy things. You can do so much with them for the Lord, but you could do so much evil for everything else. The question is, brothers, what are you doing? We're so busy now. I've noticed that as technology has improved, we have gotten so busy to spend time in fellowship, to spend time in study, to spend time with other brothers. There's a lot of brothers at home right now. They're probably like, you know, I'm going to zoom it out. I'm gonna watch it on Snappy Chatty or whatever. Why? Because we're too lazy to get dressed and come out to service. We're too lazy and we've gotten so comfortable. Yeah, I'm watching the service. Babe, can you make me a snack? So now you're hindering your wife from enjoying service because she's making you a snack. Your children are not with you. They're in their own room. Technology, it does have a purpose, but it also has its destructions. Men, learn from the past. These men have died and shown us the way. God died. Jesus died for your transgressions to cover your sins. Should you not live for him the rest of your days? Whatever you have here, guys, I am dead serious. This is your life here on earth. I'm going to give you a little bit more. Some people say, this is your life on earth. I'm going to give you this. This is your life on earth, all right? If you die at 75, I'll give you a little bit more, all right? You die at 80, okay. If you get to 100, man, you might as well just live it out. However, just like him on the cross, this is your eternity. You'll never fathom it. I'll live for eternity any day than live for the moment here and now. You guys are my here and now. Because anything I do for the Lord, it's for eternity. Anything I do for vanity, it's just for the moment. Look at my hair. I used to have a full set of hair when I started the men's study. You guys did this to me. All them prayers. Anything we do for God, guys, will last in eternity. Anything we do for ourselves is only for the moment. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I come before you this evening. I thank you for your word. I thank you for these men. I would pray, Lord, that they would go into their groups invigorated, that they would go home, Lord, ready to lift up their arms, Lord, to be those men that do not fear going into the throne room and worshiping a living God, and be those men that you could see Jesus coming out of their pores. And Lord, help them to get rid of all the weight that ensnares them, Lord. And I just ask that as they go to their groups, Lord, that you would be glorified and honored in their questions and answers, and that, Lord, you would go before them. We give you thanks, honor, and glory. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everybody said, amen. We can go to group now.